everyone, welcome to the Friday Bible study of the Father's House Ministries. We're so glad that you're here with us and you're joining us today. So thank you very much for taking time off your busy schedules and for sitting where you are and preparing your hearts to receive from the Lord and to get into God's word in depth. So thank you for doing that. And as always, before we start, I have to thank my God for giving me this opportunity to bring his word to you. So all glory to him. Also, big thank you to Pastor Raja for yet again giving me this opportunity to share his word. And I also need to give a very special thank you to Sean and Inthi, who works relentlessly, diligently behind the screens, behind the scenes, to bring these studies to you so that you can enjoy them and you can be blessed by them in the comfort of your homes. And also a big thank you to Pastor Timothy for this wonderful recording devices and the space that we have that enables us to do these studies comfortably. So with that being said, let's get into the study this evening. So let's begin with a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for giving us yet another opportunity, God, to gather together and to hear your word, to study your word, and Lord, to be engrossed in your word, Father God. I pray, Lord, that even as we go through these studies, Lord, you will minister to us, Father God. Remove every disturbance, every hindrance, so we could receive and be edified and become the men and women that you have called us to be, God. Thank you, God, for your presence with us this evening, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Okay, so for the month of July, for the next three Fridays, the next 3 weeks, we will be covering the topic of heart of service. So that's what the Friday Bible studies are going to be on for this month. So the first segment, the first session on this study series that we are going to look at is titled as preparation, basically preparing yourself to serve the Lord. So that's what we're going to cover today. Okay. All right. So before we begin, or rather as we begin, let me present this question to you. Is every child of God called to serve the Lord? Let me reiterate that again. Is every child of God called to serve the Lord? What do you think? Think about it for a minute. Now, some of you might think, well, maybe some people are called for it. They are chosen, they are anointed, they are gifted. So, you know, maybe it's for some. Some of you might disagree and say, no, I think it's for everybody. Every child of God should do it. Regardless of what your answer is, I'm going to show you what the Word of God says about this. Are you ready? Okay, so let's look at John 15 verses 9 and 10. Let's look at John 15, 9 first. It's not appearing here on the screenshot. Right. So I will read it since I have it here. John 15, 9. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. So you can see it on your screen now. Now, if we look at this verse, these two verses here, there are two branches that Jesus is talking about. One aspect, he's talking about the love, and the other aspect is about commands. So I'm going to break this down for you further. Go with me to Matthew 22, 37 to 38. Oh, coming up on screen. Right, so let's go through this. Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. Let's have 37 again on screen for a minute. Now, if you look at this commandment, this is known as the greatest commandment. It's all about loving God. Now, I want to throw in Deuteronomy 6:5 here as well, just to show you one more thing. Deuteronomy 6:5. Okay, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. So there is an additional category added there called strength, right? Sorry, Sean, I'll have to request for Matthew 22:37 again. Yes. Now, look at the way God wants His believers, His children, His sons and daughters to love Him. We are called to love Him with our heart. We are called to love Him with our soul. So the soul is the human part of you that consists of your human will. That's where you make decisions. Your human conscience, which tells you the right from wrong. And your human feelings and emotions. That's the soul, the human part of you. And then also your mind. That is to do with your thoughts, your logical thinking, your decision-making abilities, the thinking side of you. We are called to love God with that. And Deuteronomy 6:5, we saw, we are called to love Him with our strength. Meaning what? Your physical body, your physical anatomy. And in the month of June, we did an intensive study with Pastor Raja on the body. And God expects us to express our love for Him through our body. So how do we do that? By consecrating our bodies, by taking care of our bodies, valuing, loving our bodies, and refraining from doing things that dishonor and disgrace God with our bodies. So your body is also involved in this process of loving God. Your soul is involved, your mind is involved, and your heart is involved. So in other words, God wants you and me, His children, to love Him with our entire being. It's not just in your heart or in your soul only. No, your entire being has to be involved in the process of loving your God. That is why it's called the greatest commandment. That is the greatest commandment Jesus gave in the New Testament, because all the other commandments in the Old Testament are summarized, condensed in this one. Because when you love your God this way, automatically you will keep all the other commandments in the Old Testament. It happens automatically because your life, everything about your life is going to reflect your love for God. So this is the first aspect that God expects from His children. Once you are born again, once you receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the next most key thing that God expects from you is your love for Him. And remember, it's not just one-sided love, holistic love. It involves your whole being. And in this commandment, Matthew 22:37, there are three types of love. Love your God. Love your God. And you also call to love your neighbor and to love yourself. Now, there are three levels of love here. First is loving God, loving your neighbor. That is, you love everybody, okay? Not just the people you like, but even the ones you're not that good with. So you love them. And love yourself. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. It doesn't say love your neighbor as you love your God, love your neighbor as you love your spouse, as your friend. No. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. So in other words, the Lord wants us to love ourselves, our bodies. Because why? We are created in His image and likeness. So when we love our neighbors, who are also created in His image and likeness, God expects us to do that for ourselves as well. So these are the three levels of love. And the love that God expects from us, again, is a holistic love. A love that involves your entire being. Okay? Now that is the first aspect. Now in this verse, John 15:9-10, there was another aspect. Jesus also says, if you love me, you will keep all my commands. In the plural, mind you. Commands. So one we already looked at. What is this other command that he's talking about? So before I get to the command, as a precursor to set the foundation, I want to take you to John 15:16 to show you something. John 15:16. Yes. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. Let's keep this on screen. Now, I want us to zoom into this phrase here, and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Okay, let's ponder on this phrase a little bit in this verse. Now, for something to last, in our day-to-day life, for something to last, we look at quality, isn't it? That is why people like to, one reason why people spend a lot of money on buying branded products. You spend a lot of money and you purchase something that you like for a huge amount of money. Why? Because that when it's branded, we have that idea, that consumer mindset that this is going to last for long. This is of good quality. This is manufactured well. This is made well, produced well. So I'm going to spend money and buy this because this is going to last me for a long time. Why? We are buying quality. We like to invest in quality. So even if it costs us a lot, we still like to buy it. Why? Because we get the idea that this is an investment. This is an investment piece. I'm making an investment here because it's going to last me for long because of quality. And this is a reference that Jesus is making here. Bear fruit, fruit that will last. So what is this fruit that Jesus is talking about here? He's talking about the fruit of your life, the fruit of your inner man, your inner woman. And what is that? The fruit of your spirit. The fruit of your spirit, which is reflected in your character, and your character resonates through your lifestyle. The way you speak, the way you behave, your attitudes, all of that is connected to your character and to the health, the condition, the quality of your spirit. Interestingly, if you look at the definition of the world for a fruitful person or somebody who's deemed to be successful, the criteria is a bit different. In the eyes of the world, if you're considered a fruitful person, if you're maybe highly educated, you have a lot of qualifications, you have a lot of money, you have a lot of assets, you have power, authority, titles, all the grandeur and the splendor of the world, if you have it, you are successful. You are a fruitful person. But unfortunately, that definition, that criteria of the world, what the world sees as fruitful, doesn't tally with this. Why? Because every reward or every accolade achievement we achieve on this earth is temporary. We have to leave it here when someday we have to depart from this earth. You can't take your qualifications with you to heaven. You can't take your house, your property, your money, your titles, your possessions. They won't go with you. But what is going to go with you is your fruit. Fruit in within you, the fruit of your spirit. That is what's going to go with you. That's what holds your life together. Because remember, precious people of God, the very core of a human being is in the spirit. Okay, that is why when somebody is declared dead, the body is there, but the spirit is not there. And when the spirit departs, nobody can bring it back. Because the sole authority and copyright of human life, the origin of human life, is with God, the Creator God. Nobody else can dabble with it. We can't impart spirit into human life. You can't. Once it's gone, it's gone. So that is why, that is where the core of our life is in the spirit. And this is the part that we can't see. This is the part we neglect the most as well. But that's the part that Jesus is emphasizing, because that is the part that's going to last. Now, we're going to do a little experiment. I'm going to remove the phrase, fruit that will last, okay? And now if you read this, still this verse makes a lot of good sense. Makes a lot of good logical sense. So basically, you live a good life. You live a life that honors God and you bear good fruit in your spirit. You live a virtuous life in accordance with God's word and will. And then obviously, whatever you ask in Him, you are going to receive. Why? Because when you are walking with the Lord in that level, automatically you will begin to desire things that God has for you. So you will be able to discern God's heart for you. So when you ask for it, you will receive it. Makes perfect sense, right? But why did Jesus have to throw that in there? Fruit that will last. Why is that coming in there? Now that is what leads us to the command, the next most important command that Jesus gives in the New Testament. This is where that leads to, right? Let's go to Matthew 28:19-20. Yes, this is known as the Great Commission. Some of you might have memorized this also. Great Commission. Let's look at this. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. 20 as well. And teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Right, let's keep it at verse 19, Matthew 28, 19. Now, this is the Great Commission. The Great Commission is exclusively solely on ministry, on serving God. Okay, Now, I want to break this down for you very quickly. Look at the first aspect. Go and make disciples of all nations. So, disciple is somebody who has already accepted the Lord. Yes, there may be baby Christians, new Christians, but they're people who already have knowledge of Jesus and salvation. So, what is the Bible saying? Going and make disciples of all nations. So, how do we do that? By building them in Christ. Building their characters in Christ. Yes, you can preach and speak to them, but remember the best way to go and make disciples, discipleship is through your own life, through the example of your own life. If your life, if your behavior, if your attitudes do not reflect Christ, no matter how good your theology is, no matter how accurate your Bible studies are, people won't be able to receive, because when they look at your life, they don't see anything that you are speaking. Basically, you have to practice what you preach. If not, it doesn't matter how qualified you are in theology or what titles you have in ministry. It doesn't matter. Your life has to reflect Jesus. That is the first and best way to make disciples. Okay? What you say, you have to support with your life. That is the first aspect. Building people in Christ. Next aspect. Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. This is talking about the evangelism part, where we are called to share the gospel with people who don't know anything about Jesus. That's the second one. Verse 20. Yeah. And teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Ah. So that means we all are called to be students of the word and we are called to be teachers of the word. Did you see that? Teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. So all of us, the Lord expects all of us to teach his word to others. And remember, precious people of God, you don't need a pulpit. You don't need certain public platforms to always teach the word. No, you can do it where you are, as you are. It can be a one-on-one teaching. It could be for small groups. It can be for large groups. Doesn't matter. And some of you might be like, oh, I'm very shy, I have stage fright, you know, I can't get up in front of people and speak to a large audience. Fine, if that's the case, it's fine. Use the digital platforms, use WhatsApp, use email, use social media, share your devotional messages, share your testimonies with people. Use those platforms to teach people, to share the gospel, to build people in Christ. Use them. Just yesterday, I had a wonderful lady from our church. She sent me her testimony and the testimony of her family through WhatsApp. It was beautiful and it really encouraged my faith. It was such a powerful testimony. And she had presented that very nicely on WhatsApp. So see, simple ways in which you could share the gospel with people. But it creates a profound impact. So this is what Jesus is talking about here with the Great Commission. It's solely on serving. It's solely on ministry. Now, remember we spoke about fruit that will last and we just left it hanging there? We have to go back to that now. Okay? Now, if you look at Matthew 28, 19 and 20, the very last line, look at the very last line. And I will be with you always to the very end of the age. Okay? And John 15, 16 said, go and bear fruit that will last. If you think about it, both those phrases, Jesus is indicating time. He's talking about time. Why? Why is he talking about time? Because the God we love, the God we serve, the God to whom we belong, he's the Alpha and the Omega, he's the beginning and the last. Okay? And this God is outside the earthly realm of time. He controls time. He's beyond time. He's not contained, refrained, restricted by time. That is why God doesn't have an age. Do you know how old God is? Nobody knows. God doesn't age. He's immortal. He's divine. He has no age. You can't measure God with earthly time, with earthly days, months, years, seconds, hours. No. You can't measure him that way. He's beyond that. But everything else that he created on this earth, human life, animals, nature, man-made creations, all of these are time-bound. Everything has an expiration date. We all have lifespans. Even if man makes something, it's also time-bound. That's why we have terminology like depreciation, wearing out. Some species go into extinction, death. What are these words? These words are referring to time. Time, duration. So when such a God who's eternal, who's not time bound, who's talking about fruit that will last and he's going to be with you till the end of the age, you need to know, precious people of God, he's not talking about fruit that you need to only bear on this earth. Okay? No. He's talking about fruit that will go on for eternity. This might be a bit of a, you know, deeper theological disposition and revelation, but that's okay. I know you can handle it. All right. So such a God is talking about eternal fruit, fruit that you will bear eternally, in eternity. The next logical question you will ask me is, but we are human. We all have to die one day, right? So how can we still be bearing fruit that's going to, you know, last forever? Good question. Good question. I'll show you how to do it. You can do it if you invest Jesus in people, in other people. You go and share Christ with somebody, that person, after that, is inevitably going to go and talk about Jesus to somebody else. And so on. The domino effect continues. It's a cycle. It'll continue. Without you knowing, now you have impacted someone's family, someone's lineage, someone's bloodline, a generation of people, maybe a whole community. You never know how it's going to be impacted. You just only spoke to someone, but look at the impact it's having. And yes, you will die and go. But the seed you planted, the investment of Christ you made in that person, that is still going on. Still going on. Even after, maybe years after you have passed on, still what you did is going on. You are bearing eternal fruit. Did you see that? Your fruit is still being born. What you did. And the Lord gives eternal rewards. That is why the rewards for this he gives you in heaven. Whatever reward you achieve on this earth, you get on this earth for your hard work, will give you a lot of pleasure for that moment. But remember, it's time bound. You have to leave it. It's temporary. Which is why such rewards God gives you when you go to heaven, because you will have it with you every day after that. For eternity, it's going to be with you because you're doing something of eternal value, investing Jesus in people. And how you do that is through the Great Commission that I showed you. Building people, teaching people, and sharing the gospel. There you go. Eternal value. And go with me to 2 Timothy 1:5 as well, just to show you this as well. I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Can you see? Faith travels from generation to a generation. The investment we make of Christ in other people travels from one generation to another. You cannot stop it because it is the work of God. It is a work of God. You can't stop the word of God. It will continue to go, flow and grow through people. Through people. Whoever this grandmother Lewis, we don't know who shared the gospel with her. Right? We don't know how she came to know the faith, but somebody has. Can you see? Somebody has. Somebody has prayed for her. Somebody has taught her about the Lord. And can you see? It's going down. And now Timothy is obviously passing it down to so many other people. So this has eternal value. That is why the fruit that Jesus is talking about, the fruit of your spirit that emanates from your spirit, has eternal value, is eternity bound. It will not just finish after your lifespan, it will continue to go on. So remember that question that we asked in the beginning, is every child of God called to serve the Lord? The answer is, what do you think? The answer is yes. Every son and daughter bought by the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ is called to serve him. Called to serve him. Why? Let me summarize it again. Why? Because, number one, God expects us as his children to love him wholeheartedly with our whole being. And as a result of that relationship we have with him, we are to demonstrate that, share that relationship with others. And that is what you call ministry. That is what you call serving the Lord. Just to give you a practical example, just imagine everybody in the Father's House ministry, everyone who's serving, doesn't serve. No pastors are going to preach. So no preaching, no Bible studies, no media ministry, no Sunday school, no counseling, no youth ministry, nothing. And everybody's staying at home, just focusing on their relationship with the Lord. What is going to happen? Firstly, there won't be church. There won't be anything called church because nobody's serving. And the gospel is not going to continue then. Because if you and I don't share the gospel with other people, how is it going to go to the next generation? It's going to come to a standstill with one group of people. And then when you have a crisis, you have a problem in your life, guess what? No pastor to call to. Nobody in a church to ring up. Why? They're all busy with their relationship with the Lord. And please don't quote me wrong now. I'm not saying you don't have to do it. Yes, you have to have your relationship with the Lord, but you also have to serve Him as a result of it, because that's what He has commanded you to do. So you have to do both. On the flip side of it, sometimes we get so caught up in serving the Lord that we ignore the relationship part. That is also dangerous, because that's when you get worn out and tired and discouraged, and the enemy can attack you because you're vulnerable now. You're not connected to the source. You don't have provision, you don't have protection, and you're doing things for God. So what do we do about this? What we need to do, precious people of God, is we have to balance this. You have to do both, because God has commanded us. He wants us to do both. He wants us to be in relationship with Him, and He wants us to serve as well. Great commission. Look at my hands for an example. Think of this as the relationship with God. Think of this as serving. Can I just clap with one hand? Do you hear any sound? Sure. Do you hear any sound? No, not sound. Now do you hear sound? What am I doing? My relationship with my God is equipping, empowering me to serve Him. And now when I bring them together, there is an impact created. There is a sound created. I'm doing something. I'm making an impact in the kingdom of God, in the lives of other people. Do you see? That is how it works. That is what God has called His sons and daughters to do. All right. And if you are considering getting into ministry, or maybe you're somebody who's already in ministry, I will humbly encourage you and invite you to align your ministry with the Great Commission. Because at the end of the day, you need to do things that God has asked you to do. So just align. And if you're in ministry, evaluate, reflect on your ministry and see whether your ministry is edifying, building people in the Lord, whether it's sharing messages from God, teachings are happening in your ministry, and if you're reaching out to non-believers, because these three elements have to be there, because that's what Jesus said. Even the fivefold ministry is aligned with this. All right, so I would encourage you to do that, precious people of God. And finally, just in case you're still not very convinced about the characteristics of a believer that God expects to see in His children, I will have this up on screen for you. The three characteristics of a child of God. So after you receive salvation, these are the things that the Lord looks at to see if you are a genuine child of Him. First one is your relationship part. Love God, love others and yourself. Second part is the good fruit part, bearing good fruit, which is the fruit of your spirit, right? Maintaining the fruit of your spirit that will be reflected in your character and in your lifestyle, your righteous living. And the third one is bear good fruit that will last. That is the ministry part of it, investing Christ in others. And remember, you can invest Christ in others in a million zillion ways. You don't only have to be a pastor or a Sunday school teacher. No, you could do it in so many, many ways. God has given His body so many beautiful creative talents, creative gifts. So you could do it in multiple ways, not just one. All right, so there you go. Now we looked at the need, the importance for every child of God to serve the Lord. So the next question I'm going to present to you is, now that we looked at this, so can we just serve God? Let me give you a couple of examples. You have a very important exam to face, and you are informed of it today. Can you just sit for it tomorrow without studying, without revising? Can you? If you do that, the chances of you failing are pretty high, isn't it? So what do we do? For an important exam we have to face, we study, we prepare for it. We put a lot of effort, we go for tuition, we revise, we do whatever we have to do, we put other things on hold, and we study. Why? Because that exam is important and you want to get through it. So you prepare for that, don't you? When a woman conceives, when a mother conceives, she gets the test result, okay, I'm positive, I'm pregnant. Does she give birth the very next day? No. 9 months are given, the Lord has given 9 months, yes, for the child to form, but also for the parents to be prepared, because parents have to prepare mentally, physically, emotionally, financially to accommodate this new human being into their lives. It's preparation there. You meet the love of your life and now you want to get married, you want to have a nice wedding. Can you do it the very next day? No. Again, you prepare for it, isn't it? You budget, you book your vendors, you go for marriage counseling. That's preparation. So for all these important life milestones in human life, with education, achievements, pregnancies, marriage, these are important human life milestones. For all of this, we put a lot of effort and time into preparing. But when it comes to serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, do we put that same effort? Think about it. Do you put that same effort into preparing for that? In all humility, I would like to share this little incident that happened in my life a few months ago. So when I preached in our church on the 16th of April for the first time, just before I went on to preach, I had a few minutes that I was able to talk to Pastor Raja. So I was talking to him, we were talking about ministry. And then I told him, you know, Pastor, when Dilrukshi sent me the message from you asking if I could preach on this day, I wasn't surprised. I knew that God will give me this opportunity because he had already told me this a few weeks before. So I wasn't surprised at all, Pastor. I told him that. And then he looked at me and then he said, yes, Devanka, that's because you are a prepared vessel. You are a prepared vessel. Those words resonated with me a lot. And that day, at that time, I understood the importance of being prepared. Doesn't matter how anointed, how gifted you are. If you are not prepared on your end, God can't use you in his kingdom, in his ministry. He can't bring opportunities for you because you are not ready for it. You have the potential. You are equipped for it, but you are not ready on your part. So I want to ask that from you. Are you preparing yourself to serve the Lord? And this is for people who are already in ministry as well. It doesn't matter. You may be in the ministry for 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 10, 20, 30 years. Every time you get a chance to minister to someone, to do something for the Lord, do you prepare for it? Do you do what you need to do for it? Or do you just take it for granted and, you know, I'll just go and do it. I've been doing it for 10 years. I know how to do it. Reflect. Okay, so that leads us to our next section, which is our final section. How do we prepare for ministry? Okay, so I'm going to share 4 points with you and then we'll wind up. So the first point is to have a genuine and steadfast relationship with the Lord. You can't serve the Lord effectively and bear fruit if you don't have a proper relationship, a connection with him. You have to be connected to the source. Because when you are connected with the Lord, the richness that you have in your relationship with the Lord will flow into your ministry. That is when you begin to bear good fruit. Not just good fruit, but fruit that has lasting impact in the lives of others. If not, it's just your effort only and you get tired and worn out. So always remember, your relationship is what needs to fuel your ministry. Your relationship with God is what needs to fuel your energy in serving God. So that is point number one. Very important point. Point number two, righteous living and godly character. Your life, remember, has to be a walking testimony and a walking gospel for people. Because sometimes, precious people of God, we won't get hours and days and years to talk to people about God. Sometimes you might just have like, what, 2-3 minutes in the bus or in the train or when you're flying on the plane. You might just have a few minutes sometimes. And at that time, you have to share the gospel. So how do you share all of this? Sometimes it's just your life. People look at your life, the way you handle your problems, the way you handle your waiting seasons, the way you handle pressure, the way you celebrate good things in life, the way you handle the weaknesses of others. People are observing. People can see. So if they don't see Christ in that, if they don't see biblical principles reflecting in your life, then it's going to be very difficult for them to connect with you, to receive or even to hear out what you have to say. And this is very sad because without character, you can't sustain. You won't be sustained in the kingdom of God. And I have seen this happening to people, which is sad, but it is true. Sometimes this aspect is missing, but they are committed and they serve the Lord. They have giftings, all of that, but this is missing. So somewhere down the line, you don't even find them in ministry. Why? No character. character is what will hold you, will protect you, safeguard you in your ministry. Okay, second point. Point number three. Align your heart and desires with God's will. Now, sometimes some people get into ministry because they're forced into it. They're pushed into it. There's a need and somebody asks you, can you come and help out here? And you do it. But you might not even like to do it, but you still do it because you don't want to, you know, displease that person, or your parents are pushing you, or your spouse wants you to do it. Your family wants you to do it, so you do it. That's one reason. Sometimes people get into ministry because they like that ministry, or they like the people. They like the atmosphere, or they think that they have a gift or a talent in that area. So they think, okay, I'll do this. Sometimes we get into ministry because of other extrinsic motivational factors, like titles or positions. You get certain benefits, rewards from it, right? Now, if these are the motives of getting into ministry or serving the Lord, when challenges come, when the storms of life come, like it comes to every area of your life, it'll come to this area as well. When it comes, it'll be very difficult for you to stand through those storms. One reason could be is because you have not aligned yourself with God's will and plan for your life, for that ministry. Go with me to Proverbs 3:5-6. Let's have a quick look at that. In all your ways, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your path straight. So can you see? God expects you to depend on him. Align yourself with him. So if you are thinking of serving him, align with him. Ask him, God, what do you want me to do? That is very, very important. Aligning yourself. Sometimes people get discouraged and they leave ministry, they backslide because they get hurt and they go through difficulties in ministries, because sometimes they're not called to do that. God has not given them the grace for that, and that is not God's will and plan for their lives, but for whatever reason they joined it. And when things get tough, when the going gets tough, now they blame God and they backslide, and sometimes they're not even in the Lord. This is very sad, but during my lifetime, I saw this happening. They were very passionate for God. They did everything, but when challenges came, they left. They couldn't withstand it. And today, they're not even in the Lord. Very sad, but this happens sometimes because of lack of discernment. We don't align ourselves with God, what God wants us to do. Sometimes it's the right ministry, but the wrong time. Sometimes God wants you to do something 3 years from now, okay? But you get very excited and you go ahead of God and you do it now itself. What do you think is going to happen? There was also some people I know, God told them to do the ministry now, and it was a difficult time in which he told them to do it, but they didn't do it at that time. They waited till circumstances aligned and other things got sorted and they were comfortable to do it. And when that time came, a couple of years after, they tried to do the ministry. It was a flop. Wrong timing. Timing is absolutely important in the kingdom of God, precious people of God. When God wants you to do something, you do it then and there. You don't postpone it for the next hour or the next month, next year. Never going to happen, period. You do it then and there. Because sometimes certain opportunities in life, God will only bring once in a lifetime. You may not get a second chance sometimes. Sometimes, okay? If that is the case, when if you miss it, you miss it. So don't miss the timing of God. Discern the timing. Align yourself with God's will. And another reason sometimes is when the seasons change in your life and in your ministry. Sometimes the Lord is saying, son, it's enough now. I want you to move to this area of the country. I want you to go to another country or maybe go to another church and serve, because there's a need there. That is where you're going to be effective. But if you are clinging on to your comfort zone and you're like, no, God, I have to be loyal. I have to be here. You're missing out. Yes, you can continue to serve, but no fruit. Fruit bearing won't be there. Fruitlessness you will see. And you'll get discouraged, thinking, I'm putting all the effort. Where is the fruit? Maybe check your alignment with God. Maybe the answer you'll find there. Remember, precious people of God, wherever the Lord leads you, whatever he wants you to do, he will always provide for you. He will always make a way for you. Psalm 23:4. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Even through the most difficult times, if it is something God wants you to go through, you are well looked after by God. He will send the provision. If he wants you to sow in a famine, sow in a desert, do it. You will prosper. Yes, the world may laugh at you, circumstances may be against you, but you still do it because he has called you to do it. And he'll give you the grace for it. And now you might be wondering, so how do I know God's will for my life, and how do I align myself with the Lord? You might be wondering, right? Answer for that can be found in Jeremiah 29:13-14. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. Next verse. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. So this is about seeking God. There is no easy way, no shortcut to do it. Okay? Sometimes, yes, the Lord might give you some direction through somebody else, through a prophetic word or something. Yes. But don't depend on that all the time. Don't let that be your guiding source in life. No. You have a spirit, right? Jesus died for you. He wants to communicate with you. So when you have needs, you seek him. Yes, ask people to pray for you, but you get on your knees and you pray and you seek him. You wait on him and he will answer you. He will answer you. All right. And on the topic of seeking, we are going to go to a final point for today, which is obedience. Thank you. There you go. Obedience. This is extremely important, not just in ministry, but in your day-to-day life as well, obeying the Lord. And let me give you this ultimatum now itself. I'm going to tell you the truth now itself. If and unless you are not prepared and ready to obey the Lord, don't seek him. Don't seek God and don't wait on him if and unless you are ready and you are willing to obey the Lord at all costs. Don't seek him. Because if you do that, if you seek him and when God answers you and you don't do it, guess what that's called? That's called disobedience. Yes, disobedience, which God considers a sin. That happened in the Garden of Eden, remember, with Adam and Eve? That is so bad. And that's a sin before the Lord. So if you are not ready to obey him, then don't seek him. Before you seek him, first you prepare yourself to seek him. And you make the decision in your heart that whatever the Lord wants me to do or say, I will do it. Regardless of how difficult it may be for me at that moment, I'm still going to trust and do it because I want to obey God. Obedience is key, precious people of God. It's key. And remember, obedience doesn't come to us human beings naturally. It's a spiritual discipline that we have to discipline ourselves into. For example, if you have really little children, you know, obedience doesn't come to them naturally. It doesn't come naturally, isn't it? That is why we as teachers or parents, caregivers, we have to train the child. We have to discipline the children to accept answers of yes and to accept answers of no. We have to train them to obey the answer of no and obey the answer of yes. Yes, you can do it, or go and do it. Child needs to learn to obey. Or the parent says, no, you can't do it. Don't do it. Child needs to learn to refrain from it. So see, from a little age, in our human formation, from the tiniest of ages, we train this to children physically. Listen, obey, obey what you're told. That same training we have to give to our spirit man as well. We have to train ourselves. We have to be intentional. Train ourselves. I am going to obey. I am going to do this. I have decided to do my devotions for 1 hour every day. Then from 8 to 9, I'm going to do it. Put my phone away, shut myself up in the room. I'm going to do it. You have to be intentional. You have to discipline yourself. Now, there were 3 common reasons that I identified why children of God, people of God, struggle with obeying, obedience to the Lord. One is because of pride. Remember Lucifer? Lucifer was a created being. God created Lucifer for what? To worship him. He was a created being. He had a task in heaven to do, to worship, to obey God and worship. But pride got into his head and he wanted to be God. He wanted to be like God. And then the Lord had to chase him away from the kingdom of heaven. He was banished and we got stuck with him. Why? Pride. Sometimes our pride in our hearts will keep us from doing things what God wants us to do. Sometimes it's pride. Another reason is ignorance. Ignorance. Remember the Garden of Eden? If you carefully study the temptation that the enemy, the devil, brought to Eve, you will see something in it. He tempted her not over something she didn't have. He tempted her over something she did have, but she was ignorant of it. What were his words? Eat from this fruit so you will be like God. Hello, she was already made in the image and the likeness of God. She already had the makeup of God and she already had the character and the nature of God. She already had it, but she was ignorant of it. She didn't know that she had it. The devil knew it. And he took advantage of her ignorance. She was ignorant. She didn't know. And she disobeyed. So sometimes our ignorance of the word of God, ignorance of what the will of God for our life can lead us into disobeying. All right. And the third reason is because of external pressure. When God told Moses, strike that rock once, he went and struck it twice. Did he intend to do it? Was it his intention to disobey the Lord? No. But the pressure that was put on him by society, by the people around him, caused him to disobey his God. And this happens to us also. Sometimes we want to do the right thing by God. We want to stand up for God. But our work culture puts pressure on us to not do it. Or your family can put pressure on you. Your loved ones, your friends, your neighbors, your community, the country, the government, the economic systems can sometimes put pressure on you to do things that are wrong before the sight of God. And sometimes we give into it out of fear or frustration. That is another reason why God's people sometimes fall into disobedience, is because of the pressure that is put on them that causes them to disobey. So I want to encourage you this evening, even as you have listened to this study, to visit your life. Have you been obeying the Lord? Are there areas in your life that you can improve better in terms of obedience? If the Lord is bringing such areas into your heart right now, precious people of God, I invite you to humble yourself. First repent and then make the decision to obey Him. Start where you are with what you have. And the Lord will give you the grace to proceed thereafter. Okay? All right. So, in conclusion, I want to share with you one quote that I found was very interesting. When I stand before God at the end of my life, I would hope that I would not have a single bit of talent left and could say, I used everything you gave me. By Irma Bombay. She's an author. Let's keep this on screen. It's a beautiful verse. But I want you to reflect on this as a final thought to our study this evening. One day, when you are called to go home, when you have to face your Father God, what can you take with you to present to Him? What are you planning to take with you to present to Him? Or are you going to go empty-handed? Will you be able to tell Him, Father, I used every talent, every gift, every ability, every resource you gave me. I use it to honor you. I use it to glorify you. And I use it to serve you, God. And this is what I bring to you. If your answer is yes to that, praise God. But if your answer is no, or I'm not sure, revisit your life and see how you can present those to your Father in heaven so that you won't go empty-handed. But you will go taking the best that you could offer Him, because He deserves our best at all times. So with that, we will conclude the first study session of this series. So thank you once again for joining with us. And I hope this blessed you. And I hope this got you thinking. So I will see you all next Friday, same time. So until then, stay safe. Stay blessed and may God bless you. Thank you.
turning back, no turning back, no turning before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning.
No turning back, no turning back.